Thank you. This will be about static analysis of C++ code. I more or less assume you know what static analysis is. Not everybody perhaps knows what Cppcheck is. Who has heard of Cppcheck before? I don't know if anybody didn't hear about it. Okay, it's a very simple tool. It is designed to be very simple to use. That was a key design decision. With low noise, you don't get many false warnings. It's open source. We have had 250 contributors in 2018. It was 64. I started Cppcheck in 2007. I was going on the train to work. I was living in Eskilstuna and went to Stockholm to work. And I wanted to have something to do on the train. So I thought I will do some small simple tool to find some bugs. I will do it in 2 weeks and then I will finish because I will get tired of it because nobody wants to work too long on such things. But then after 2 weeks I had my tool and it found some bugs, and well, I thought this was very fun to work on, so I continued working. And I haven't lost my interest yet. It's entirely a hobby project. We don't have any paid developers. I have worked in total 1 month for payment in this project. How Cppcheck works? If you know compilers, it's quite similar. There is a preprocessor, a symbol database that looks up all functions and takes care of all scopes and types. We have an abstract syntax tree. Those are all compiler common. Value flow analysis is also common in compilers to do optimizations. But then in Cppcheck, we have also knowledge. We have something called a library where we store many information about different functions and types. And then the last piece of Cppcheck is the checks. And in the analysis time, I would say that the first three items here, it takes the most time. So we don't spend the checks that people think that we normally do a lot. That is not where we spend so much time. About knowledge, a compiler is very happy about this simple code. A compiler, if there is a function call, it only needs to know what the arguments there are and what it returns, and then it can compile this. This is, for a static analyzer, we have no idea what happens here. A static analyzer would like to have many pieces of knowledge. What are the allowed arguments? Is it okay to pass a null pointer? It's so many things. We can't just look at this. So how does knowledge in Cppcheck works? We can come up with some knowledge through code analysis. If we see the do stuff function somewhere, then we can analyze it and determine that, oh, this doesn't allow null pointers, or you can pass null pointers, etc. But it's kind of limited. It's very difficult to come up with knowledge this way. Annotations is also possible, but there are not so many annotations to use. We have quite a list here that we want to know, and there are not so much annotations. And then there is configuration. In Cppcheck we have XML files that is distributed with Cppcheck. So there are thousands of functions that are configured. If you download Cppcheck, you have all this information. Here is a simple example how Cppcheck code can look. We are iterating scopes. This is iterating all scopes in the translation unit. Then it checks if the scope is a function. Then we iterate through all tokens in a scope. This is like one body start. And here is one body start. One body start is here, continue. This is just one statement in this body. And then we can look at the token if it's division. This is how I look at the type of the token. This here I check if it's an int. This means that the result of the division is an int. And then I can look at what are the possible result values of this division. In this case, actually, I look at the operand 2. It's our right-hand side operand of the division. If that is 0, I check here. If it's not never 0, then this will be null pointer. So this is basically how it looks. Here is a short C versus C++ code. In the upper do stuff, we have the code does exactly the same, but it's from a static analyzer perspective, it's very different. In the what are the possible undefined behavior in this code example? Well, if str is null, then there will be a null pointer reference here. If it's garbage value, then there will be garbage value here. If the buffer str is less than 10 bytes, then there will be array index out of bounds here. So there are many possible errors here, but it's very difficult. None of those are conclusive. Cppcheck can't warn about any of those unless it see how do stuff is called. In the below example, we can clearly see if we know what string is, that it is a string class, then we know that here we compare it against hello, and then there is an array index out of bounds here. It's no question about it. And we don't have to know what how it's called. Here is, I think it's the first bug I wanted to detect with Cppcheck. When I was once sitting on the train, I started working on this. It's a class that in the constructor does not initialize a private member. And if you use this class wrongly, then you will have an error. If you don't think that this should write warnings, then I totally understand it's your code. But I think this is a good warning to fix. In the Debian source code, there are 97,000 warnings like this. So I don't know, maybe many of them are intentional, but I would say there are many thousands that are not intentional, and I guess there are many security bugs here. In Cppcheck, we have a concept called containers. This is part of the knowledge in the library. A container is a class that this is, I guess you know very well, store items. It's a class that has a size, and then you have methods that return size if the container is empty and so on. It's a std vector, std array, std list, std string. Everything is containers. There is a subclass of containers called array. The difference is they are accessed with these and operators, and the index must not be out of bounds. You can access a std map with this operator, but there will never be an index out of bounds on that. And then there are containers called strings. They are also like arrays, but Cppcheck can have extra semantics for string literals. If you initialize with a string literal, then we know that this is the value. If you compare it with the string, then we know what the value is. So how can Cppcheck use this concept? It can use it for data flow analysis of containers. And we can use it for different checker heuristics. We know that containers behave in certain ways. If you compare a container and check if it's empty here and then you don't modify it, then we know that it's empty later also. So it's quite useful. Here is the same code again, and this is the warning that we write. Either condition hello is redundant, or the string size can be 5. So this is what you get. In the Debian source code, there are 513 such bugs currently. Since knowledge is configurable, you can easily check other containers also, not just standard string or something. This is a Qt bug, the same. You get the same warning if you pass this library equals Qt. You can check Wix widgets and other frameworks also. Containers, negative index is also, there are many such bugs also. If there is a standard array, array container that you pass a negative index, then Cppcheck will warn. And the nice thing about this is that we need no data flow analysis to check how big the array container is. We just know that if you pass a negative index, it's a bug. So in the Debian source code, there are 917 such bugs. We can have various checks for iterators. Here's two different expressions to create iterators, and you compare them. There are 409 such bugs in Debian. I would not say that this will crash in many cases. It will just mean that some code is unreachable or always executes or something. We have lifetime checkers. So we check how local variables are captured or stored in containers and lambdas. If you capture a local variable in lambda and then return it, we will warn, etc. So there are 964 bugs where this is leaving the scope of the variable. Some best practices, so you, how can you help static analysis? I think you should write well-written code, because for Cppcheck, it's hard to read the code. If you have lots of go-tos or something in the code, then it will be both hard for you to read and hard for me to read. And you should, of course, use algorithms if you can. Don't try to write everything yourself. I think you should consider using several tools. Each static analyzer has unique analysis. But there are problems, of course. You have usability. It can be quite hard to configure all tools so they work well. And developers can be confused by different warnings. So it's not easy. I want to talk quickly about dynamic analysis also. I think it's a good complement for static analysis. The plus of dynamic analysis versus static is that it's very good at deep analysis. This is where static analysis fails, and you can achieve very good. A dynamic analysis only checks for bugs, errors, and does not find the inconsistent coding. Both static analysis and dynamic analysis does not have full coverage. In dynamic analysis, you only check the code that you execute and the paths that you execute. In static analysis, you don't get the deep analysis. Okay, questions? Yeah?
Did you write the C++ parser yourself?
Yes. The symbol database is mostly written by a guy in USA. Yes?
Do you have a favorite companion static analyzer? Someone that covers the weaknesses of the Cppcheck?
I usually run try to run Clang in also. But I think I use Coverity also in the Cppcheck project, and it's quite good. Yeah?
How do you handle heavily templatized code and parameter packs and so on?
Ah, that's a tough one. I would not say that Cppcheck is perfect when it comes to templates. We handle many common templates if you write template code, but when you come to a library code that is very difficult or boost or something, then we don't handle it very well, unfortunately. But we expand it as best as we can to normal classes, and then we analyze the code, and then the templates that we fail on, they remain in the code and we check them unexpanded.
Okay, thank you, Daniel.